Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you to this very exciting talk by Dr. Geraldine Horan. The topic today is the teaching of the art of swearing to language learners, language students. Geraldine has been working at UCL since 2000.
Yes.
She's head of German, and she's currently working, among other projects, on a sociolinguistic history of swearing in German since the 16th century.
Roughly.
Quite exciting. I wonder what were the swearing words in German in the 16th century?
Pretty similar.
The Twitter for this event is at UCLLHL, event code 8774. After her talk, we are going to be taking questions from the room and also from our audience online. So now with Geraldine, thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Welcome. Thanks for coming. Bon appétit. Before I start my talk, I would like to issue a trigger warning. Rather predictably, this talk about swearing will include swear words. So if you are offended by swear words, now would be a good time to leave or cover your eyes and ears. And I hope it doesn't put you off your lunch, but we will see. So I'd like to talk about the role, the function of swearing in languages, and whether we should teach this or include it in our language teaching to learners of language in general. Now, as children, and sometimes, if you're me, as adults, we're often told that swearing is not clever and it's not funny. But in fact, it can be both. And the fact that swearing is humorous and clever or creative can be a good reason for including them in language teaching. But there are other reasons as well, other important reasons, as I hope to outline over the next half an hour or so. But I'd like to start really by asking you to reflect on your own language behaviour. Do you swear? You don't have to answer. It's just sort of self-reflection. Do you have a favourite swear word? Or do you have one that you save for special occasions? Are you a prolific swearer, or do you indulge in swearing avoidance? Are there swear words that are completely taboo for you? If you speak more than one language, which language or languages do you swear in, and why? Now, some of these questions touch on central aspects of our everyday communication and also on our identities as language users. So if using or conversely avoiding bad language is part of our communicative patterns, then isn't this something that we should include in teaching a second or a foreign language? Now, I talk a lot about swearing, as well as practicing it. It's called living the dream. And people often say, well, you know, this is nonsense, this idea of teaching swearing. How would you do it? Luckily, the internet has some suggestions. Would it look like this?
How to say bad words in German. Asshole. Arschloch. Arschloch. Now you try.
Now you try.
Shit. Scheiße. Scheiße. Now you try.
It's spelt wrong. Yes, exactly. And so on. So my 11-year-old... Yes, exactly. My 11-year-old had good fun with that yesterday. The short answer is no, that's really not really what I mean about teaching swearing. Because as we know with language acquisition in general, it's not so much about learning vocabulary That's important, obviously, as it is about knowing when to use it in what contexts. Learning a variety of communicative styles and patterns, something which in sociolinguistics is called communicative competence. And that's really where my interest lies. My argument would be, when we teach languages, we tend to, or are we turning out compliant, polite language users, ones that are somehow perhaps too polite and too naive? And is there a way of perhaps redressing that? So to give you an example of a sort of typical dialogue that you might encounter when you're learning English, two university students having a conversation, it's all very pleasant, all very polite. It contains lots of important dialogue, lots of important vocabulary. That's all very nice. But could it, such an encounter, be phrased differently? Like this, for example. It's not unimaginable that swear words might come into it. Now, this is quite important because it not only tells us about speakers' attitudes to the activities described, revising for an exam and so on, but it also perhaps tells us something quite important about their relationship, that they are friends, perhaps, or that they are bonding, showing some sort of solidarity and familiarity through using swear words. So this is another aspect, I think, that we need to include when we're looking at swearing and its place in everyday conversation. So it's expressive, it's humorous, and it has a bonding function. On a more general level, we tend to be a little bit squeamish about looking into bad language or dirty words, as it's called here. And as the linguist and psychologist Timothy Jay has said, we need to do a lot more research on it. And if we don't, then we are ignorant, ignoring the totality of human expression. So I would then transfer this to language learners. Are we denying them access to very expressive, colourful forms of the language, and are we also denying them the means to draw fully and capably on this resource? I wanted to say a little bit about what swearing is, what we mean by this. And actually, it's not that easy to define what swearing is, so I've taken a very general, for my understanding, a very general, explanation definition of what swearing is. So this is by Lars Anderson and Peter Trudgill. Swearing refers to something that is taboo or stigmatized in the culture. It should not be interpreted literally. As soon as you use the F word literally, it is no longer a swear word, and it is used to express emotions and attitudes. Another researcher, the maledictologist, what a lovely job to have, someone who researches swear words, Reinhold Ammann, came up with these very quaint categories of the kind of swear words we use, sort of naming them after the people that use them, blasphemers, so religious curses, often we refer to it as cursing, defilers of the family, so insults predominantly relating to the mother, I'll leave that to your imagination, and prudes, so swear words that draw on sexual taboos, parts of the body and bodily functions. Now, a lot of European languages tend to draw on categories 1 and 3, and in particular number 3, what a German linguist who's researched swearing, Hans Martin Gauger, refers to the moist and the dirty. Very nicely put, I thought. Why do we swear? You could say, who the fuck knows? But obviously there is a reason why we swear. It is a form of release of tension. We release because we release our anger through language, because we are in pain, we are angry, we're frightened, we're shocked, we're surprised, we're delighted. And if you swear in response to a stimulus, you're not just uttering some words. There is actually a physiological response that comes along with swearing. Your heart rate increases, Your blood pressure does, and there is this release of tension and emotion. It's the usual sort of hammer on the thumb moment. And it can function as a form of pain relief. You might have heard that several years ago, I think it was about 7 years ago now, some researchers at Keele University conducted an experiment where they asked participants to plunge their hands into a container of icy water. And those that swore while doing it were able to keep their hands in longer compared to non-swearers. So in short, swearing is good for you. Perhaps it should be on prescription. But in moderation, because those people that plunged their hands into the water and swore and were regular prolific swearers did not get the same benefit. So again, swear, but swear in moderation. That would be the message. And that is, of course, something that we need to communicate to language learners as well. Now, it's interesting, although swearing has this very central function of releasing emotion and attention, it's nonetheless regarded as dirty, as contaminatory, something that soils your mouth as well as the mind. And this is perhaps no surprise, given that a lot of swear words draw on bodily functions, excretion, for example, or on sexual activity. And in English, this is communicated in expressions such as wash your mouth out with soap. Somebody's accused of having a potty mouth in American English. But it's actually a bit more than just this association. It's more about our social attitudes to swearing. If we follow the ideas of the anthropologist Mary Douglas, who claimed that we tend to associate social order with purity and cleanliness, then swearing is dirty and is a sign of social disorder. And this is why it tends to unsettle us as social beings. As it says here, bad language is often seen as a rebellion against the norms of social interaction, and we tend to stigmatise both the user and the language as lazy or vulgar. And we also discipline people. We punish them for using swear words. There are plenty of examples in Germany, for example. You can be fined €300 for saying "leck mich am Arsch," kiss my ass, to a police officer, for example. If you are very, very wealthy and you can afford it, you can say "du Wichser," you wanker, but that will cost you €1,000. So think about it. But in the UK, we're sort of slightly milder in our fines. You may have seen this story in the newspapers today about plans by Rochdale Council to introduce a swearing ban to fine people £100 on the spot. Rather predictably, when they interviewed residents of Rochdale, older residents tended to be largely in favour, because they saw it as swearing as a manifestation of antisocial behaviour, whilst one 23-year-old resident commented, "It's bullshit. The council need to get their heads out of their arseholes," which is an entirely appropriate response, I would say. So it's quite interesting that... Nothing, because they haven't introduced it yet. So he escaped, luckily. A recent study seems to suggest that people that swear a lot tend to be more honest than their non-swearing counterparts, perhaps because they feel less constrained by social niceties. So we have this contradiction or this conflict, really, between regarding or stigmatising swearing, but it also fulfilling a central function. Now, as I said, I'm concerned with the should we teach swearing rather than the how should we teach swearing. Luckily, as a sociolinguist, I only need to come up with the questions and not so much on the answers. So here are my arguments. I think we should teach swearing because, as it says here, swear words can be versatile, creative, and humorous. These are some recent examples of rather creative swear words in English. And of course, they're constantly changing and reflecting cultural interests. So this gives a lot of information about current taboos and also about how we place sometimes quite incongruous concepts together to form a swear word. So the linguists Anderson and Trudgill, who mentioned earlier, they describe the F word, for example, as one of the most interesting and colourful words in the English language today, because it can function as a verb, a participle, a command, an intensifier, an adjective, and a lexical component in compounds such as halla fucking you, luya, and so on. So we need to actually, in some respects, celebrate the creativity of language as far as possible. We should teach swearing to language learners because swear words are culturally specific. They give us a lot of information about the emphases and the taboos of particular languages. German is known for being a particularly excremental language. So much so that linguists have tended to label it a Sonderfall, a special case. Why is German so obsessed with poo? One rather interesting hypothesis is that until relatively recently, German babies were swaddled very tightly, sometimes until they were a year old, which meant that they were sometimes lying for long periods of time in their own excrement, and so the obsession with poo began. Unfortunately, that doesn't really hold up under scrutiny, but I think it's an interesting hypothesis nonetheless. Swedish, by comparison, tends to use religious swear words. I'm afraid I don't speak Swedish, so I'm reliant on literature about this. And similarly, Russian relies on sexual swear words. So we need to sort of compare languages and understand these particular focal points. And it's also important for language learners if they try to translate from one language to another. So to give a personal anecdote, when I was learning German and was in Germany, I thought I would translate a casually funny, oh, where are my fucking shoes, into wo sind meine verfickten Schuhe, and then observed the gasps and heard the gasps of horror among German speakers, and I quickly realized that this was not something that could be transferred in a very straightforward fashion. So whoops is the short answer to that, but it's something I think we need to be aware of. Now, it's not just looking across languages, at different languages. Even within a language, there is considerable variation according to region, according to age, according to gender, for example. So a study conducted in the year 2000 by Andrea Millwood Hargrave looked at the word bastard, for example, and participants in the study reported, well, 40% from the Midlands, 39% from the North regarded bastard as very severe, whereas in the South it was only 26%. Maybe that's something to do with pronunciation, that bastard sounds worse than bastard. And interestingly, we have a slight gender differentiation. Women found it more severe than men. So again, this can really be the subject of debate on even within a language, how there can be considerable differences in use and in attitudes. We should teach swearing because swearing, as we've said before, is an important feature of emotional speech. And Gerard Mugford has done some research into impolite, learning impoliteness strategies, and he points out this idea that, as I've said before, language teaching tends to deal with the pleasanter side of second language interaction, such as making friends, relating experiences, expressing likes or dislikes, while ignoring everyday communicative realities such as rudeness, disrespect, and impoliteness. So, for example, we teach people to say, can I please have a ticket to blah, blah, blah at the railway station? But it doesn't teach them to say, oh shit, I can't believe my fucking train has been cancelled again, which would seem to be quite important in that respect. And my colleague from Birkbeck College, Jean-Marc Devalle, claims that without such knowledge, speakers perceive themselves and are perceived as quite bland, and they often become quite frustrated about not being able to express themselves more fully and more forcefully. We should teach it because language learners are interested in rude words, and interest is something that should be harnessed. We've all had experience, I think, of trying to find out what are the rude words in any language, as you can see from these publications. And again, it's something we really need to draw on in language teaching, not least because many speakers like to use swear words from other languages. To give an example, German has borrowed very heavily in swearing, particularly with the F word. The one example at the top is a badge by the Unilever company, who ran a campaign about their foods, and the slogan was "Fuck the diet." So the F word is frequently used. Here's another example from the Berlin Transport Company. And other words such as shitstorm, which is used frequently, and in rather wonderful combinations such as Schokol shitstorm, a chocolate shitstorm in a row about chocolate Father Christmas figures. The point being that borrowed words are not perceived as quite as offensive, which is fine, because if you donate a language, you can't ask for the words back. But it's important to alert language learners to the fact that back in the donor language, the swear words might be perhaps more powerful and more offensive. Which brings me to my next point. We need to teach swearing precisely because swear words are powerful and they are dangerous. As is said in the quotation here, they are the verbal equivalent of nitroglycerin. So inappropriate use of swear words might have devastating social consequences. Now, you think that might be a reason to not swear or to not address swearing, but actually, I would say it's the opposite. You really need to look at the consequences of swearing, the effects of swearing, and not leave it to the internet. So, rather predictably, I would say yes, we should teach swearing precisely for some of the reasons I have outlined. Swear words are a central and important part of emotional language. Swearing is used, or not, as the case may be, in specific contexts, not only to express our emotions, but also strategically to express group solidarity, in-group solidarity, humour, to diffuse tension, and is often part of a speaker's identity. Swearing is often associated with being part of casual speech, non-standard speech, slang is often referred to, is a central part of youth language. It's where we get a lot of our more creative swear words from. But we should also not forget that it is also a part of so-called highbrow culture. I'm sure you can think of key literary texts that include swear words. In English, you've sort of got a trail running through from Chaucer to Shakespeare, for example, Philip Larkin, Irvin Welsh, Trainspotting. In German, we have Goethe's von Berlichingen, which includes the phrase "Leck mich im Arsch," kiss my arse, and so on. So I think we sometimes forget that there is a more cultural side. And finally, swear words are powerful. They can be offensive, they can offend, they can discriminate against particular groups. So some of the examples I've shown you are sort of slightly funny and lighthearted, but if they're directed at an individual or a group, they can be extremely violent, and speakers have to be made aware of the consequences of using language, particularly swear words, particularly if they head in the direction of violent or hate speech. So conversations should be had about this. I wanted to finish off with, I think, a very fitting quotation from Stephen Fry, who addresses this stigmatisation of swearing and counters it, I think, very effectively, and shows us that actually swearing constitutes a rich storehouse, a rich linguistic inventory, and that's why we should discuss this with our language learners, enabling them to draw on the totality of human expression and use language that really has expressive and cultural value. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So now we can take questions. Over there.
Thank you very much for the talk. Very interesting. I do a bit of the psychology behind language learning, and I had a specific question. I mentioned to you, you mentioned research by Diwali, and I think it might be her or him, I don't know, that has done research on finding out that second language learners or users find it much easier to swear because of the lack of emotional associations with that language.
That's right.
So given that you think it should be taught, do you think it will have the desired effect of becoming more fluent, like, in the language?
That's a good question. I think if it's handled critically, then I think that's where the importance is. You're not going to stop people from learning swear words. I don't even think you're going to encourage it by making them aware of it. I think actually the more you show the potential outcomes of swearing, I think the less or the more sensitized perhaps language learners will be to when and how they can use it. Of course, there's obviously, you know, the excitement of using these bad words. But I think if you explain the context, then I think that can diffuse it, hopefully.
Okay, thank you.
You've got two now, two for the price of one. Like London buses.
Thanks a lot for the talk. You mentioned a lot of, well, you mentioned that swearing can be a sort of painkiller and that there's been done research into this, but at the end you talked about violence, and I was just wondering, has there been any research done towards how swearing can make people violent or how it influences violently or...
Oh, that's a can of worms. Yes, I mean, there is some diverse opinions on this. Some people do say that swearing is a sort of gateway activity. And once you swear, the step to other antisocial forms of behaviour, such as physical violence, is not so large. I think particularly when we get into violent sort of hate speech, name-calling, I think that's where you do have to be very careful. Yes, I mean, there is I suppose using that sort of language uncritically or using it with the intent of hurting does perhaps desensitize you to being in other ways offensive or violent. But generally, on a sort of metaphorical level, I think there isn't any particular evidence to suggest that swearing leads you into criminal activity or antisocial activity.
Hi, Geraldine. Thank you for that lovely lecture. I feel I haven't sworn enough today. I get six a day.
It's not too late.
A requirement of vegetables and fruit.
It's gone up from 6 to 10.
Yeah,
yes.
I'll do that when I see my students this afternoon. My question is, I come from a new literacy studies background, and you know, Bryan Street and Barton and so on. And as you probably know, they make a distinction between imposed and vernacular literacies. I suppose universities have always been places where we've dealt with imposed literacies, talk like this, write like that. And part of the pleasure I remember as being a language student was the fun of learning those vernacular literacies with French people when you're on your year abroad, for example, rather than in the classroom. I wonder whether or not actually if we're saying we should be perhaps teaching bad language in the language classroom, we're actually taking away some of the fun that might be had, the vernacular fun, the dissentient anti-establishment fun.
I agree. I mean, it is extremely cringy to talk about this. There's nothing worse than your teacher talking about swear words. I agree. I think we are, in some respects, at risk of running into that sort of more unregulated, sort of spoiling the unregulated aspect. But I think the fact that it is unregulated is perhaps problematic. And I think it's doing it a disservice. I think it's doing the whole subject. It's sort of confining it to these in sort of unregulated encounters. And as I said, I think bad language more generally is part of our culture, however you understand that. So I think it is something that needs to be addressed in some shape or form, so that it's not left to chance encounters and bad mistakes, as I've experienced myself. And also, as a sociolinguist, I think we quite like to sort of take away the moral aspect and say that all language is valid. Of course it is. It can be hurtful, it can be dangerous, but we can't say that something is lazy, or we can't say that something is clumsy or ugly. We're talking about different varieties and different registers. So it's sort of put in that broader context, but I get your point.
There's one question over there.
Thank you for an interesting talk. I seem to remember reading a few years ago an article suggesting that swear words are totally different from ordinary language in terms of the localization in the brain. It was a functional magnetic resonance imaging study. The language centers were sort of behind your left ear, but the swearing was sort of midline of the brain, which is apparently where monkeys' alarm calls come from. So it could be that there's some sort of function like that. Do you know about this work? Do you have any comments?
Yes. I mean, obviously, I'm not a neurologist or a neurolinguist, but I have read, yes, that in response to immediate stimulus, pain or otherwise, it's apparently located, swearing's located in the limbic system. So it's a very sort of primitive part of the brain. So that's perhaps not the sort of thing you can teach. If you drop something on your foot, you respond immediately and often respond in a way, a language that's most familiar and most intimate to you. I think we can't really control that. I think what we can look at is the more strategic use of language. So when we're using it for particular effect. So that's a sort of different side of swearing. But I agree that actual immediate response is not something that can be taught.
Lots of questions. There is one question here and then over there too. Sorry.
Hi. You make a very good case for including it in language teaching, but I'm wondering how you would do it. Would you... would you have a separate session on bad language, in which case you would get a very good turnout?
Yes, exactly.
Or would you do it in a more integrated way? You know, the practicalities of including it in the syllabus or in the curriculum. Have you given...
Yes, I mean, so there are some language learning materials that do deal with it. The German publisher Huber, for example, has a swearing pinwheel where you can sort of set your particular situation, and then you can swivel it round to see which swear words might be useful. Other textbooks have sort of thematized it, as in they've taken a text about the F word and then have sort of done it like a reading comprehension or a sort of a basis for discussion. And I can see, yes, I mean, if it's week 8 bad language, then that might perhaps be, again, sort of running the risk of taking it out of its context. I would sort of use perhaps particular opportunities to thematize it. So looking at song lyrics, looking at a poem, for example, looking at something from the internet, looking at social media language, and from there, from this example, sort of initiating discussions about appropriateness of particular types of bad language. So a more integrated, discursive approach. But I agree, it's a challenge. And also, perhaps not with children, with older, more advanced learners, perhaps.
We have one question there, then we're going to take one from the online audience, and we go back to yeah.
Thank you. If you're teaching language and you teach the swear words as well, what do you do with words such as racist words,
yes,
words that are abusive of women.
Yes.
Do you count these as swear words, or do you say they're, no, they're not swear words, they're something else, which is much more prohibited, and there's no place for them at all? Or do you say there is place in a certain context? How do you deal with it?
That's a really good question. They generally tend to be regarded as swear words. And if you look at sort of studies into people's attitudes to swear words in the UK, for example, number one tends to be the C word. But once you get a little bit further down the list in the top 10, you will begin to have racist swear words. I think you have to draw attention to them. You have to alert learners to the fact that they exist, but that they are extremely offensive. So I think it is perfectly appropriate to say that some words are just not acceptable in any context, and to highlight the fact that they are a form of verbal or written violence. In that. So again, I think it comes to a discussion and a discussion of the responsibility and effects of using words. And I think there's nothing wrong with saying that some words are totally unacceptable because of the violence that they carry with them. So yes, particularly directed at another person or a group. Yes, so I think that would be definitely a part of it.
Hello.
Hello.
There are a number of questions from Slido, so I think we've covered most of them, but I'll read these two out. In terms of swearing, what do you think of Steven Pinkner's language as the window into human cognition? And I don't know if you can answer this one, but what language has the largest variety of swear words?
Oh, gosh.
Gosh?
Yes. There's another research project. for the first question, I am ashamed to say that I don't know. And the second one, I'm also ashamed to say I don't know. Because my studies so far have been very, very restricted to European languages, in particular contrast between English and German. So that's very difficult to say. I mean, I think perhaps on a communicative, pragmatic level, I would say perhaps that English allows more opportunities for swearing than German does. I think in some respect. No? You disagree? Russia. Russia. You see, I need to learn more languages in order to learn more swearing. So,
Hungarian.
Okay. Yes, exactly. Another lunch hour lecture. But it's interesting that I find in the comparison between English and German that perhaps English has a sort of broader a broader context for swearing. But I will definitely look into Hungarian and Russian.
One more question?
I think you had a question or no?
No,
so, over here.
How might you convince people, particularly teachers at school, for instance, that swearing is actually sort of, it could be sort of beneficial for lifestyles? Like, how would you do that without potentially them saying, no, that's definitely not allowed? Because that would be a teacher's automatic reaction.
Yes.
That's definitely not okay.
Yeah, that's true. No, I agree. And that's why I said age is a consideration. I mean, I would counter it by a totally false analogy and say, well, we teach sex education, for example. We teach about drugs, for example. That makes me cringe slightly because I don't necessarily see language as something that can be equated with these behaviours. But it is something I think that teenagers in particular know about, that they use, and particularly now in the sort of age of social media, I think it's even more important that we actually tackle bad language and contextualize it. Maybe take some of the heat out of it and explain that there are contexts in which it's perfectly acceptable if you're with your friends, for example, to use certain language, but perhaps not to bully someone online or not to use in a job interview, for example, unless it's for a swearing researcher.
I think if we could potentially do that online, I think the discussion section on YouTube would be so much better to read.
Yes. So it's not really about sort of being the language police, but sort of alerting people to the consequences of their language behaviour. But yeah, I agree, it's not an easy task.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming for today's lecture, and you can probably keep on discussing.
Yes, come and swear at me. Come and swear with me. Thank you. Thank you.